Hello everyone. In this episode of beginner series, we will discuss the high availability options we have with Azure Database for MySQL Flexible Server. I'm Sudhish Narayan Swami, and I work as a senior program manager with Azure Database for MySQL Server. Let's see what all we will cover today. We will check why we require high availability, the high availability architectures available with Azure Database for MySQL, our commitments on billing and SLA, and also we will detail on few failover scenarios with demos. Why HA? Whenever I think about high availability, the Murphy's laws comes to my mind. Anything which can go wrong will go wrong. And when something goes wrong, we have to be ready to handle that situation. That's where the high availability of the service is very important to us. In general, high availability of a system or a component is the ability or the quality of the system to perform over a period of time. When we talk about the high performance or high availability of a database, it is to do with how much uptime that database service can provide. Now, usually the architecture of the database service is made such that it does not have a single point of failure, and it can fail over whenever there is a problem on the node which is working. We usually monitor a database, and then whenever a failure happens, we fail over to the healthy redundant node. When we talk about high availability, few terms are very important, like SLA, service level agreement. It's a commitment which a service provider gives, which mentions the uptime of your service. The second one is RPO, recovery point objective, which talks about the data loss which is acceptable for the application. Recovery time objective, which measures the downtime which your application can occur when there is a downtime. Now let's check on the HA architecture. Before we move into the details of how HA architecture is, let's have a quick recap of how the flexible server architecture looks like without an HA being enabled. As you can see in the picture, the compute and the storage is decoupled. The clients directly connect to the compute. The storage maintains three copies of data and logs. The storage is on the Azure Premium Storage, so that if there is an event of a failure of the storage, we have two more copies of the data intact and we can recover it from there. The data and the logs are also sent back to the local redundant storage or geo-redundant storage as you have configured for backup purpose. This you can use for restoration of your database at the time of any kind of a failure or if you, whenever you want to do point in time restore. In zone redundant high availability architecture, you would have two flexible servers, one on each zone, which would have compute and Azure Premium Storage with three copies of the data as you would have on a non-HA server. And now the data which is being stored in this Azure ZRS storage is semi-synchronous replicated into the standby zone storage and then reapplied onto the standby, keeping the standby ready at any time to take charge of. In the event of a failure of the primary node where the clients connect to, the connections are dropped which are coming to the primary server. At the same time, the standby zone is made primary and the old primary server becomes a standby. As it has exact replica about the data, the new connections which are coming in will be directed using the DNS changes into the new primary server, which can now accept the read-write workloads. Now, moving on to the same zone architecture, there is no difference between the architecture other than the placement of the standby server, wherein in the same zone, it will be placed on the same availability zone as compared to the zone redundant HA, wherein we place the standby in and primary on two different zones. For the storage, we use the local redundant storage and the backups also uses the local redundant storage backups. Now let's look at a quick demo on how we can create an HA-enabled Azure Database or MySQL flexible server. To create a HA-enabled flexible server, you navigate to the portal and click on create a resource for Azure Database for MySQL flexible server. On the create resource page, you might have to give the subscription name, resource group, server name, which needs to be unique, region, which you want the server to be created, and the workload type. For HA, you should either give production or production large size, because we don't support burstable SKUs. It is only supported for general purpose and memory optimized SKUs. So you could select one of those options. Moving to availability zone, you can either set it no preference, which would mean it will take any of the three zones from the availability zone, or you could specify one specific zone here, which would make sure that the primary server would be actually hosted on that. Look at the MySQL version which you would like to have, and then coming to the high availability option, which is the main configuration here, is the ability to select same zone or zone redundant. Now, if you are using a same zone, then you cannot later convert back to zone redundant. But if you select zone redundant, you always get an option to specify a zone. Also, it gives you the capability to later disable the HA server or move it back to same zone or zone redundant HA. This is a create time option, zone redundant. Later, you will not be able to change this option. So we have to be careful in selecting this option. If you would like to have it in zone redundant, please do select it at the time of creation. Post that, give the username, password, go and select the networking which you would need, specify any tag required, and then click on review and create. Approximate estimation is 20 minutes for the primary and standby to get created and being operational for you. Once everything is finished, click on create. Now, let's look at our commitments. SLA, service level agreement. As you can see, if you have a zone redundant HA, you will get 99.99%. For a same zone HA, which would have the standby on the same zone, we would get 99.95% as an SLA. And for the non-HA server, we get 99.9%. Moving on. How the server is being built. Just a recap that we have two servers, one is a primary and the standby. So the billing is almost two times of what you would have for a non-HA flexible server. You would be billed two times. We also charge an additional 36 IOPS, which we provision and block it to make sure that whenever we have a failover, we don't have problems when getting the resources required for the failover to happen. Now let's quickly check on the post server create experience for an HA enabled server. So once a server is created with HA enabled options, you would see under the properties tab, right, on overview pane, that it will tell you like what is the high availability where it is enabled. You would also see whether it is a same zone or a zero redundant. You also see what is the availability zone of your primary server and what is the availability zone of your secondary server. You also have a high availability pane, which also gives you these informations of primary and standby availability zone, the status of it, and also an option where you can disable or enable the high availability. So if you would like to disable the high availability, you can just go ahead and click on this and save the options. This will make sure that the availability option is taken out and this or the standby server is dropped and it becomes a non-available server. You can later enable high availability and select either zone redundant or same zone HA if you have selected the zone redundant before. If you have selected same zone, or if you have not selected, the only option available to you would be the same zone HA. Coming to failover scenarios, we have two kinds of failover supported. One is a planned failover, or we call it as a forced failover, or you can have unplanned failover. In either of these cases, the RPO would be zero, which means you will not have any kind of a data loss in an H-enabled server. And also the RTO will be somewhere around between 60 to 120 seconds. That is a failover time between standby to primary server. For planned, it will be still lower. It will be between 30 to 60 seconds in most cases. When we talk about planned failover is somewhere where you would like to do a test of your HA solution, like, or in case of, let's say, a DA drill or a disaster recovery drill, you would like to do it and you wanted to fail over your application from one node to another node and see what's a failover time, what's an RPO, whether it's affected. That's where the forced failover would help. And for unplanned ones are the one where the software crashes, something happens to the hardware, there's an infrastructure problem on the primary, any of these things, which is usually monitored by our health monitoring system. When it identifies that there's a failure, it will trigger a failover automatically, which will actually make the old standby current primary and the old primary a current standby. And redirect all the traffic from the old node to the new node to make sure that there is a continuity in the service. Now let's check quickly on how we can do a manual failover of an HA-enabled server. On the Azure portal, on the high availability pane of Azure Database for MySQL Flexible Server, you would see an option to do a forced failover. You can see that currently the primary availability zone is 3 and the standby availability zone is 1. Right. Now, I'm going to initiate a forced failover clicking on this link. Now, this will let me know that this operation would fail over and it will take approximately 30 seconds to complete. If I press on OK, it will initiate the failover. Now, you can see that the failover is complete and you would see that the primary availability zone has changed to 1 and standby has changed to 3. For more details on high availability with Azure Database for MySQL, these resources would help. It's already there in the description. Thank you. And if you have any further questions, feel free to write back to us on the email ID mentioned here.